kind of bums me out. I'm like at the front of a stage in front of like 20,000 people. I've gotten used to just doing that every f***ing day. I do that and then I make an album, and I've been doing that for 7 years, you know, and that's until a couple of months ago, that was going to be my future for another year and a half. So of course I take it for granted. We're all like striving to connect. Do you know what I mean? It's just amazing. So sorry to get emotional. That's a f***ing weird thing to do, really. Hello, I'm Matty from the 1975, and I'm here to break down all of my albums. The 1975-2030. Apocalyptic teenage romance. Still our most conceptual record to date, even though it was our debut album, a weird debut album. It was the apocalyptic sense of being a teenager in a major key. Put a bow on it. That's that record. The feeling of being a teenager. It's like the apocalypse. It's like everything that happens, you have kind of zero responsibility for, but is the most important thing that could ever happen. Like, to be honest, at 23, if it looked like my band was going to get big, I probably wouldn't have made that as my first album, because it is super reaching, and people were a bit like, what? Like, you know, like, Robbers came to embody the feeling of that album. Not my best lyrics, not my best construction of melody or whatever it may be. It's so, like, youthful. I love listening to that record, you know what I mean? Because I'm not there anymore, you know? And it was quite a special time as well, because no one was watching on that record. It's like this really pure teenage melodrama. I can remember wanting to die on the hill of the first song is called The 1975, and the album's called The 1975, and the band's called The 1975, and I know that I was like that. It was the start of this idea, like, honestly, I always reference video games, right? Video games used to make me feel incredibly personally addressed. They all have this, like, startup sound. Sega. They all have like a recognizable, like checking in, like they kind of like establish who they are. So I kind of wanted to do that. That idea really became kind of like concrete on the next record, because when I started doing it again, I knew what I was doing. I was like checking in. I was like, we're kind of like starting up again. Do you know what I mean? That's kind of how it feels. I remember it vividly. I remember having a big label meeting. I said that I want it to feel nostalgic, but really quite stark and modern. I remember saying, like, I don't want a f***ing neon sign, do you know what I mean? Like, hanging in an alleyway, like, ooh, the 80s and soft, you know, like, city pop and all that kind of thing. Then I thought, maybe I do want a neon sign. Because the box had already been a thing, and lighting the box as part of our live show, we'd used the box as, like, graphic over images for our EPs. It was about like actualizing that. I thought it was quite bold when I saw it, and that was the first one I saw, and that was it. I like it when you sleep, for you are so beautiful yet so unaware of it. 2016. Ego, fear, light. There's a lot of jostling with ego. I mean, I think the primary statement of that record was love me. That's me going, do I take myself seriously? Do you take myself seriously? Should I care about that? Oh, it seems like this dialogue's already getting weird. I'll take my top off. That was kind of like, that's kind of like my attitude with Love Me. Like, I don't know what to do. We were sexualized. That was weird for us because, like, we couldn't get f***ing arrested. And now we were like, what? Like, objectively cool or desirable? It was like, f*** off. Do you know what I mean? Well, it came from something that I thought and then wrote down and then laughed at because it sounded like a Fallout Boy song, and then thought, fuck it, that's the name of my album. Like, that's a bold album title. Like, it felt like incredibly emo and incredibly like in the back of your planner or something like that, your homework. You just gotta trust your instinct a lot of the time. The pink thing was very much like, but what's the opposite of what we just did? You know, that was kind of the attitude across the whole record, like something bright and not black, you know, white and pink as opposed to black and white or something. The reason that we made track-specific visuals for I Like It When You Sleep is because it was something that we'd done in the liner notes of the last record. And I've always struggled with the lack of tactility in just building a relationship with a record through reading about all those things and having that booklet or that artwork to look at and go through. Now, it was a big part of my relationship with records. And the first record just basically had loads of photos that George had taken that were relevant to each track. And then this one, we just wanted to make it a bit more conceptual. I sent Sam, my flatmate, I said, let's pick like some cool locations that mean a lot to me and go and shoot them there. So actually, a lot of those locations all have a relevance. The I Like It When You Sleep one is actually a real photo. We had to use this kind of like white space to store all of our neons because we didn't have a storage room. So we had to use almost like a photography studio space to store everything. So we set up that one in front of it and thought, well, that's perfect for it. I remember saying, you know, you should see if you can get the roof of that hotel for Lost My Head. I had a bit of an episode, to be honest, in a hotel in like the Lower East Side and wasn't pretty. You said I'm full of diseases, your eyes were full of regret. And then you took a picture of your salad and put it on the internet. That's probably the line that is the most prophetic in regards to what was to come of my style of writing. It tends to be very conversational, also normally shrouded in metaphors. Basically, how we communicate and how that is being mediated by the internet is a big theme for my writing. And I think that that's the line that really starts that. That's a real moment that's happening, you know? It's a real moment between two people, you know? And then you took a picture of your salad and put it on the internet. It's equally as important to us now, but it's not really real. Do you know what I mean? I feel that if you ever been in an argument with someone and you go, are you looking at your phone? Do you know what I mean? Like, it's like that kind of thing. It's like, but then you just are sometimes. It's like, yeah, I am, because I'm a fucking idiot. But that's what being a human is now. Just looking at your phone until you die. A brief inquiry into online relationships, 2018. The fucking internet. I became obsessed with the idea that what I described at the time as a profound, not profound realization that all of our communication is mediated through the internet. Every single facet of human communication that isn't done face-to-face is done through the internet. If you said that 15 years ago to somebody, it would definitely provoke questions that just aren't asked now. But when you're in it, it almost feels like you're that guy. Is this strange? Should we be feeling like that? Am I justified in feeling sad about this? Is that cool? I don't know. There was no, on that whole record, even like Love It If We Made It, there's no utopia is this way and you're wrong and you should change your opinion. There was no opinions on that record. It's just questions. All I know is the more specific I am in my writing, the more people relate to it. We're going through the same thing. We just got different hair and stuff. I was sat on a train and there was some woman sat next to me reading a book of essays. Their essay was titled A Brief Inquiry into Online Relationships. And I was listening to the demos of the record and I thought, that is it. It's not like a thesis or it's not an opinion. It's a brief inquiry into online relationships. Do you know what I mean? It literally is. When I make a record, I put everything into it. So by the time I make another record, it's not that the well is dry. It's just that the stuff that I do have to work with is normally like just more fundamental or like hyper specific. You know, it becomes about like the truth, the pursuit of like truth and purity. All of these ideas that kind of run through like minimalism and those kind of ideas have quite obviously inspired the 1975. This record, I didn't want to color it that much with something that wasn't particularly interpretive. You know, like Mondrian, his work was all about utopian ideals of basically kind of like they come more from the world of information than they do from the world of design. Something without its kind of own real visual language, do you know what I mean, was really important for me. At the time of I Like It When You Sleep, it was about finding that pink wall and filtering the thing, and everything was a very filtered version of reality. By the time A Brief Inquiry came around, no one wanted that. People wanted literally the biggest stars in the world to be on Instagram Live or FaceTime Live. I didn't want to do something that was like stylized for the culture. I just wanted it to do it stylized for my taste, you know? This is my favorite David Foster Wallace quote. What passes for hip, cynical transcendence of sentiment is really some kind of fear of being really human. Since to be really human is probably to be unavoidably sentimental and naive and goo-prone and generally pathetic. And what he's saying there is sincerity is scary, which is my song that is about him. That quote, I don't know if you've done like a Nardwuar thing to pull that quote, but that was one of the ideas that I needed to put out. I think the hardest thing to do really for people is to look like a dickhead in front of their mates. To say that you don't know the thing. That's what everyone's really terrified of. And we've constructed a whole culture around it. What's really important is like being naive, letting yourself like be open. Irony's okay, I suppose. Culture is to blame. You try and mask your pain in the most postmodern way.
Irony's okay, I suppose. Culture is to blame. You try and mask your pain in the most postmodern way.
You know, that's, I mean, I'm kind of like rewriting his quote. Inside your mind, I suppose, is a moment like that a little bit because it makes me uncomfortable because I wrote it when I was doing a lot of drugs and it's about like sex in a deep level.
Maybe you are dreaming you're in love with me. The only option left is look and see.
That required me to be not cynical about things, you know? It required me to be like, this is it. This is the grit, you know? Notes on a conditional form, 2020. End of era. I can't make retrospective statements. It's why I've been filming this documentary for 12 years. Every single time a statement ends, the idea to follow that with a retrospective statement, something that looks back, something that is celebratory of a previous thing, it makes me want to crawl out of my skin. I hate it. I just want to go forward. This is the only record where I do look back a little bit. I mean, I think the only time I specifically do it is in Guys. It's quite sad, and it's also like one for the homies, you know? Like, I wanted to write a love song for friends. Like, people don't have that very much. Like, I love that idea. And even if it was the fact that, like, going through the DNA of her, who we were to make this record, like, there's so much, like, reference to old emo core or house music that we were growing up with. Like, feels like we went right back to, like, we went and found all the, like, the old photos, you know, of, like, where we came from. It's almost how it felt to make this record. So when I made this record, I was like, this is the last 1975 record for ages. Not the last 1975 record, but this is definitely us stopping making music for a bit. There's essentially been lots of different album art for this record. We live in a world of, you know, iTunes uploads 6 months before the record comes out. So someone's like, we need a piece of artwork. And I keep going, okay, I'll give you our piece of artwork. The artwork changed every week. The artwork now is basically the most minimal version example of what we've had, and it's all been based on like texture and the concept of like wabi sabi, and it's all about the record's been about deconstruction. Like, the record feels like it should be just in a paper bag. I wanted to steal the Daruti Column idea. The Daruti Column, one of my favorite bands of all time, they made one record, the vinyl cover was sandpaper, so it destroyed any record that it was next to. I mean, oh my god, how badass is that shit? Like, that is so my vibe. I wish that I'd have done it. But the thing is, I love that idea so much that I couldn't have passed it off as my own. I grew up in punk and hardcore. The most punk person that I've ever met in my life is Greta Thunberg. She gave me like a sense of hope. Do you know what I mean? We're all kind of wallowing in like nihilism and what's the point. And when you meet her, she don't give you a pat on the back, tell you that much, but she means what she's talking about. We were talking about the Sega Mega Drive startup sound of the 1975, and we were talking about how that happens every time. We were like, well, what is the most modern version of that, you know? And then the conversation became, well, what is the most modern thing? What is the most modern statement? And it was Greta Thunberg. And we're like, should we get Greta Thunberg to sing it?
We are facing a disaster of unspoken sufferings for enormous amounts of people.
That idea was obviously exciting immediately, you know, like, using that platform is a great thing to do, and it's also creatively exciting. At the moment, she's one of the most important figures of our generation. But I really like the idea of formally encapsulating that in a piece of music that therefore exists in pop culture in the way that music does and goes on like a record. You know, no one's going to find a tweet about Greta Thunberg in the rubble in 1,000 years. Do you know what I mean? But if in 1,000 years they find that record, that would move somebody in 1,000 years who finds that in the rubble. This is my 10 favorite 1975 songs. Today, Face Down, Intro Set 3, Me, Falling For You, Medicine, Somebody Else, Love It If We Made It, I Like America and America Likes Me, Be My Mistake, controversial, and People.
I'm sorry that I
cried. It's incredibly embarrassing. Please don't tell anybody. Well, I've done it now. You have to tell everyone. But if you're watching this video, don't then go on and tell other people that I cried, because that's just that expands out too far. If you see it, if you saw the crying bit, that's fine, but just keep that to yourself, and then that'll be, that's the only thing I've got to say, really. Anyway, thank you, goodbye.